So American eels, also known as freshwater eels, are important ecologically and economically in the U.S. Due to demand from Japan, a pound of baby glass eels can go for over $2,000. These fish used to be wildly abundant across the eastern U.S., but in recent decades, their population has drastically declined due to things like habitat loss, pollution, the changing climate, and overfishing. But there's also another threat that's not as widely acknowledged. A parasitic nematode that infects and is capable of destroying one of their organs, the swim bladder. This is an air-filled organ, kind of like a balloon, that fish use to control their buoyancy and help them swim. This parasite is originally from Japan, but was brought to the U.S. in the early 1990s and since has rapidly spread throughout the American eel range, and now can be found all the way from Nova Scotia down into the Gulf of Mexico. So here is an example of an infected eel. Its swim bladder is circled in red, and the forceps there are for size comparison. Now here is the same eel and swim bladder, but with the parasites removed. There are four huge parasites within that tiny swim bladder. So this brings me to my project. I'm looking at if this parasitic nematode is contributing to the historically low levels of the American eel. To do this, I'm collecting eels from around the Chesapeake Bay, counting their parasites, and determining the health of their swim bladder. I've completed my first year of sampling, and I have some interesting preliminary data to share. So this graph is a bit confusing, but I'm going to walk you through it. On the x-axis, I have the number of parasites found within a single eel. On the y-axis, I have the swim bladder damage, ranging from no swim bladder damage to severely damaged. So let's start with the best case scenario, no parasites and no swim bladder damage. The size of the circle and the number within show how many eels had that combination of parasites and swim bladder damage. So there are 78 eels with no parasites and no swim bladder damage. But now things get interesting. These are also eels that had no parasites, but they had the full range of swim bladder damage. This is due to the fact that even when there are no parasites present within a swim bladder, there can still be damage due to past infections. And then moving on to the eels with parasites in their swim bladder, this was about 60% of the eels I looked at. They had more or lesser damaged swim bladders than the ones without parasites. And so, for example, the ones with the most amount of parasites I found, the 9 or 10, all the way to the side, those had pretty moderately damaged swim bladders. And then, as you can see, we didn't really find that many severely damaged swim bladders. So then my next step of my project is to use these data to determine if this parasite is causing eels to die. If we can find this to be true, then this could tell us that this parasite is contributing, or maybe contributing partially, to the historically low levels of the American eel. So to do this, we're expecting to find, or if we find this to be true, then we would expect to find a trend like this shown here. So this hypothetical graph is showing that young eels are highly infected and older eels are less infected. This can be explained by young eels that are highly infected dying early, leaving the eels that are better able to cope with the infection or resist the infection able to grow to older ages and therefore not be as highly infected. So to end on a more positive note, what can be done about this eel parasite problem? We can limit the spread of the parasite because it may not be everywhere, so we can be careful about transporting infected eels. Also, managers can account for the effects of this parasite in their stock assessments. And we can also try to reduce other stressors to the eels, such as low oxygen levels and high temperatures, that can aggravate the eel's condition.